what a genuine pleasure it is to be here today at this seminar presenting this material, where I'm hopeful to get some real meaty feedback on what I'm working on, because this is a place of real expertise on this material. Okay. In his classic study of the Jews in early modern Eastern Europe, Jonathan Israel had this to say about the Khmelnytsky Uprising, and I quote, "The Khmelnytsky massacres of 1648, he wrote, were less a major turning point in the history of Polish Jewry than a brutal but relatively short interruption in its steady growth and expansion." And taking a broad view, this characterization has much to recommend it. In both the period leading up to 1648 and in the decades of reconstruction that followed Poland-Lithuania's mid-17th century wars, it was the relationship between the highest Polish nobility, the magnates, and the Jews that was the motor driving the economy. For the Jews, this translated into an improved social status, both before and after the uprising, which brought them a great deal of money, power, and influence, which not coincidentally is the name of the book that was mentioned before. In this long-term perspective, the events of 1648 and after had little impact on the development of this, the Jews' key relationship with the magnates. However, a closer look at Israel's characterization reveals its absurdity. Estimates of Polish-Lithuanian Jewry's losses during the whole period of the wars stand at about 20% of its population and considerably more of its wealth. For Ukrainian Jewry during the uprising, the losses stand at somewhere over 40% of its population and more of its wealth. This then is no brief and brutal interruption of anything, but a catastrophic, a huge loss that should be recognized as such. Once we've done that, then we can return to Israel's perspective, but now with a new question. How was it that Polish-Lithuanian Jewry in general, and Ukrainian Jewry in particular, managed to bounce back from what was an unprecedented catastrophe? How was it that within just a decade or two, it was in a position to renew its economic relations with the magnates? After all, theirs was not a relationship born of love, but of utility. Had the Jews been unable to offer the magnates what they needed, they would have been ignored by them or suffered something worse at their hands. So, if we want to understand the full significance of the Khmelnytsky uprising for Jewish history, we must look beyond the massacres themselves, which have been almost an obsession in the historiography until now. Instead, we should turn our gaze on the survivors, for it's their experiences, and more importantly, how they dealt with them, that will allow us to understand how Eastern European Jewry managed to overcome what they called their own Khorban, which is the term used for the destruction of the temple in Jerusalem. My particular focus here will be on the refugees, those Jews who fled their homes during the uprising in search of safety. It is probably no exaggeration to say that at least as many fled during the massacres as were killed. This was a flight sometimes just to a neighboring town, but more often involved a great deal of travel in appalling conditions over huge distances while undergoing horrific traumas. To a great extent then, the ways in which Jewish society managed to reintegrate the refugees into post-war life holds the key to understanding the processes of reconstruction that I am interested in, so it is these we will be examining here. This will, I believe, have a number of benefits beyond simply understanding the events of the 17th century. In terms of Jewish history, expulsion and resettlement have been constant phenomena for at least the last two millennia. While the focus of historians has mostly been on the causes of the expulsions, i.e. anti-Semitism, and the degree of Jewish suffering involved, the continuation of Jewish life over that period must have been based on the constant ability to resettle refugees and rebuild new lives after catastrophe. This project is thus a first step in understanding this crucial but overlooked issue in Jewish history. In more contemporary terms, as Western society struggles to deal with the huge numbers of refugees created across our world, looking at the past might be of importance too. With the perspective of centuries, we can see more clearly the way refugee crises unfold and develop. which strategies are more successful in dealing with them and which less, and perhaps also how past societies managed to bring them to a more or less satisfactory conclusion. In the overwhelming chaos of the present, the shape of past events might help provide a much-needed roadmap. Following the research of Professor Richard Mollica in the Harvard Program of Refugee Trauma, my approach to the refugee experience is holistic, examining not just the social and economic issues involved, but also how questions of culture, religion, and even to the extent possible human psychology played into it too. To this end, I have divided the talk into four broad chapters. The first examines refugee experience in Ukraine during the uprising. The second assesses how Jewish society dealt with the refugees outside the war zone. The third looks at the ways in which Jewish society faced the social and psychological consequences of the refugee crisis. And the last deals with the strategies of return and reconstruction that enabled the refugees and the other survivors to rebuild their lives with such great success. Okay, so I'll start with the first chapter, which is the refugee experience in Ukraine. The early spring of 1648 saw Bohdan Khmelnytsky consolidate his control over the Cossack forces by being elected Grand Hetman, Commander-in-Chief. He was dissatisfied with the terms of his army's service given by the Polish-Lithuanian state, and so, facing a hostile Sejm, planned the rebellion to back up his claim for better conditions. In order further to strengthen his hand, he entered into a treaty with his erstwhile enemy, the Crimean Tatars, and together they had planned an attack on the Commonwealth. The uprising itself, everyone around this table presumably knows what I'm talking about, began in spring 1648 with unrest in the Cossack heartland of Zaporizhia, and then the troubles spread to more northerly regions of left bank Ukraine, causing panic amongst the Polish nobles there, who began to flee, calling for military action to end the fighting. This was not a very urbanized region, so most Jews who lived there lived just as one or two family units in those villages where they ran taverns. As the violence grew, many of these Jews, who were correctly identified by the peasants as agents of the Polish noble Catholic occupation of the region, had to flee too, making for the larger, well-fortified towns to the west of the Dnieper River. For these, the first Jewish refugees of the uprising, it was a highly dangerous journey. The huge distances to be travelled and the sparse Jewish settlement they found on the way meant that it was necessary to spend the nights with Christians, while much, probably the majority of the local population, did not harbour murderous feelings towards Jews, it was of course impossible to identify who did and whom to trust. A testimony given to the rabbinical court in Ostrog in 1649 expressed these problems, and I quote, "My husband, Avraham ben Yisrael, and I fled from the mob, going from village to village until we came to one called Zviriv. There we met a good peasant who put us up for about 3 weeks. Then my husband said, 'Let's go on, maybe we'll meet a Jew.' We came to a village called Preslovich, where I got sick. My husband sat beside me in the non-Jew's house. Then the hooligan peasants came, and a villager handed my husband over to them. They tied him hand and foot and kept him overnight. Early in the morning, they came to him and said, 'What shall we do with you? Shoot you or behead you?' He asked to be shot. Then I came and asked them to shoot me too. One hooligan said to another, 'Cut off her head.' The other answered, 'She's sick, she'll die anyway.' They shot my husband through the heart from behind and he fell. The hooligans left and I sat beside my husband. He remained alive for half an hour, not saying anything, just sleeping. Then his soul left him. I buried him with the help of the non-Jew who we were staying with." Now, what's really interesting in a text like this, with the perspective of my research, is that although clearly what grabs the attention is the sort of torture and murder scene, what the story is telling us is that this couple were actually looked after by two Ukrainian families, right? And the second Ukrainian family actually helped the wife bury the husband. So we can, when we stop looking just at the massacres, we can start thinking about other roles played by Ukrainians during the uprising in terms of rescuing. And it's something that's been totally overlooked. Nonetheless, despite all the difficulties, the refugees continue to stream westwards to areas with denser Jewish settlement. The communities in the fortified towns, such as Nemiriv, Tulchin, Ostrog, Izyaslav, Polnoi, Bar, and Vinnytsia, soon became swollen with refugees. This situation continued until mid-May, when matters took a terrible turn for the worse for both the Polish nobility and the Jews. First at Dziobtywody and then at the nearby town of Korsun, the Polish army was cut to pieces by the Cossack and Tatar forces. And as if this was not bad enough, news then reached Ukraine that the Polish king had died. Since the monarchy was elective, this meant that the Polish and Lithuanian nobility had to withdraw to the capital to begin choosing a new king. So with the Polish army defeated and the high command in Warsaw paralyzed, the field was now open for Khmelnytsky and his Tatar allies. Emboldened by this turn of events, the Ukrainian peasantry joined the uprising in their tens of thousands, changing its nature from a military uprising into a massive popular rebellion. The fortified towns of Ukraine were no match for the enormous forces thus released and fell to the rebels one after the other. Nemiriv fell on June 10th, Tulchin June 21st, Vinnytsia July 1st, Polnoye July 22nd, Bar July 25th, Ostrog and Izyaslav in the following week. So for the Jews, this was total disaster, as each town was taking its Jewish inhabitants, including the refugees who'd fled there from elsewhere, were put to the sword in a brutal series of mass murders. However, many Jews, knowing what was going to come, fled from town to town, hoping to stay ahead of the advancing armies. And they were also joined by the survivors of the massacres, right, who just wanted to get away at any price. The stream of Jewish refugees rapidly became a flood. An enormously chaotic situation ensued, with thousands of Jews on the roads in utter panic, desperate to find somewhere safe. Those who were more foresighted would prepare for flight ahead of time, either by hiding what wealth they possessed, often burying it, or giving it to a trusted non-Jewish neighbor for safekeeping. The rest had to take with them as much of their movable property as they could when they fled. This was a problem, not just because it slowed them down, but because it made them easy targets for the unscrupulous. Nathan Hanover, the famous chronicler, included a first-hand account of such a flight in his work, Yevein Metzula. I'm going to quote. It's a little long, but it's a very vivid description. He writes, "We were informed in the Holy Community of Izyaslav that the Tatars and Ukrainians were besieging Polnoye. So whoever was able to flee, fled. We abandoned our homes that were filled with all sorts of valuables. We thought only of saving ourselves and our sons and daughters. On the Sabbath eve, we were stunned by the evil tidings that reached us through the noble Vishnoviati, governor of Polnoye. He said, 'Polnoye has fallen. All the nobles and Jews have been murdered. The enemy is now attacking Izyaslav.' The heads of the community on the Sabbath day itself announced that no Jew should remain there. And I quote, 'We cannot trust the Ukrainian inhabitants of the city not to harm us.' That's what they said. Once again, they didn't say the Ukrainians are going to kill us. They said, 'We cannot trust them not to kill us.' They don't know who to trust. So everyone fled," says Hanover. "Anyone who had a horse and a cart took that. Those who did not have one, even though they had enough money to buy one, took their wives and children by the hand and fled on foot, throwing away all their belongings. On that Shabbat, there was a column three horses and carts wide on the road, and for a stretch of 7 miles, the road was jammed with horses and carts, one behind the other, and a whole throng of pedestrians. Within 2 hours, three mounted men, one Jew and two noblemen, chased after us, saying, 'Why are you going so slowly? The enemy is close on our heels.' Immediately, indescribable panic and confusion seized the Jews. Everyone threw silver, gold, utensils, books, pillows and bed covers from their carts so they could get away more quickly. Some left everything behind, including the horse and cart, and fled for their lives into the woods with their wives and children. Many who had taken their children by the hand let go of them in the panic." Hanover concludes, "Next day, things calmed down and the pace lessened. We walked from place to place through towns and villages, sleeping on the roads. And even then we found no rest for our weary souls. We were robbed and crushed, despised and hated. Every night that we spent in the Ukrainian inn, we were afraid that the innkeeper would kill us during the night." So once again, he's terrified that he's going to be killed, but Hanover survived. He survived for decades after what happened here. This account of the kind of communal flight that accompanied the early phase of the 1648 campaign paints a vivid picture of the uncertainty and fear that reigned. It also showed the chaos created when so many people went on the move at once. One or two other aspects of the experience can also be seen. The first of these concerns the transmission of information. It would seem that, though the news reported from one to another was not always accurate, and that's a common feature of wartime life, there was a considerable flow of information between Jews and non-Jews as everyone strove to understand what was going on. There is certainly no sense of the Jewish communities being isolated from their surroundings. Hanover also emphasizes in his account the breakdown of social structures involved in a flight. All the money owned by the socioeconomic elite would not be enough to get them a horse and cart if time did not permit it. Families, though they might have tried to flee together, lost contact in the panic. Parents lost children, wives, husbands, and so on. The sense of impoverishment, particularly the loss or abandonment of wealth and possessions, is very strong in the narrative. But that is also tied in with a much greater loss, that of security. The refugees seem to have felt, and indeed to have been, very exposed and vulnerable. All the physical and psychological defences built up over generations of living in the Jewish communities and Jewish quarters of the towns of Ukraine were stripped from them, and they were now seemingly alone and defenceless in a very threatening world. As time went on, the violence spread. Cossack forces moved north into the Grand Duchy of Lithuania, where there were mass murders of Jews in many towns, the largest probably in a town called Khmel, today in Belarus. In the fall of 1648, Khmelnytsky himself took his armies first to Red Ruthenia, western Ukraine, and then deeper into Crown Poland. Although the larger communities such as Lviv and Zhukva survived the sieges, the death and destruction in the towns and villages was enormous. So, the issue of the refugees within Ukraine seems to have been a truly major problem, at least in the early stages of the uprising. Tens of thousands of panic-stricken Jews thronged the roads, literally fleeing for their lives, and suffering the terrible and brutal experience of early modern warfare on civilians. If they survived, they often lost not only their homes, wealth, and possessions, but all the social and communal protections that had kept them safe until then. Social structures crumbled, and they were left increasingly isolated, though not always totally so. In fact, conditions became so difficult that many Jews did all they could to leave the war zone. The refugee issue thus ceased to be a local matter and began to affect Polish-Lithuanian Jewry as a whole. Okay, so that's the end of that section. We'll move to the second section, dealing with the refugees outside the war zone. In the introduction to his book, Tiferet Yisrael, Yisrael ben Aharon, who was at that stage, the late 17th century rabbi of Shklov, which is in Belarus, included a short autobiographical vignette, and I quote, "When I was 8 or 9, I studied with a private teacher in Tlusk, southern Belarus. It was the beginning of the 1648 massacres, and we'd been driven out of our land. My father and teacher, the pious Reb Aharon, had been rabbi in the Uman community in Ukraine, and we'd been driven out of there. Every morning after the evening prayer, I used to go up on the roof with the volume of the Talmud I had for my studies to practice reading. While I was up on the roof, I would burst into floods of tears, pray to the Holy One, blessed be He, and bang my head on the wall, all in prayer to the God of Israel that He would reveal to me the light of His Holy Torah." We can only guess at the kind of traumatic experiences the young Yisrael ben Aharon must have undergone in his flight from Ukraine to Belarus that would have brought him to such emotional extremes. What we do know is that the boy and his family were part of a flood of Jewish refugees who left the war zone of Ukraine and sought safety in the Grand Duchy of Lithuania. Quite a number of them ended up in the town of Slutsk, owned by Bogusław Radziwill, a son of one of Lithuania's leading magnate families. The appearance there of such a large number of refugees forced the local Jewish community to develop some kind of policy towards them. Slutsk was just one of many communities that took in refugees, so looking at what happened there should shed light on the ways in which the local Jewish communities helped refugees across the Commonwealth. Now, the Jewish community in Slutsk was relatively new in 1648. Though there were always religious and social tensions in the town, for the most part, relations between the different ethnic and religious groups that lived there were peaceable. Jewish refugees from Ukraine seem first to have reached Slutsk only in 1652, but by 1655, it was home to a significant number. So the first problem the community faced was to find housing for the refugees. It seems to have done this by placing them in private homes, often causing very highly crowded conditions. Now, this brought the community into conflict with the town council, which wanted to prevent any growth in the town's Jewish population. The council ordered that only those Jews whose names appeared in the town register be allowed to live there. And they complained, and I quote, that the numbers of the Slutsk Jewish population has grown so greatly that four or five families are living in a single house, which is a sign of the number of refugees that are being taken in and given somewhere to live. Another tactic was for Jews to take over houses that had previously been owned by Christians in return for defaulted loans. In response, Radzivill's commissars in Slutsk issued an order in 1648 banning both the local Jews and what they called the foreign Jews, Jews from elsewhere, which is refugees in this period, from acquiring houses and courts outside their designated streets. However, to judge by the continual growth in the number of Jewish-owned houses in the town, this order was not enforced. Now, the next issue that faced the community was to help the refugees make a living. Many Jewish women took to the streets to sell baked goods because baking was one of the few skills that female refugees could exploit in order to earn an income. And that too irritated the non-Jewish town council. Jewish men engaged in a wider range of activity, for the most part petty trade. In normal times, the Slutsk Jewish community itself would have done its best to remove these interlopers. However, in the early 1650s, the Lithuanian Jewish Council, which was a kind of regional parliamentary body, had ordered refugees be integrated as far as possible into the local economies of the different towns. Doing this brought the community once again into confrontation with the town council, which wanted to stop Jews from outside Slutsk doing business in the town. It was only in the spring of 1659 that an excuse was finally found to get rid of the unwanted Jewish population of refugees. A local Orthodox priest, Protopop, wrote to Radzivill complaining about, and I quote, a Ukrainian Jew who had become a Christian with his wife and children, so in Ukraine. After the death of his first wife, he took a second, living as a Christian for over a decade. Having now come to Slutsk, he, his wife, and children born into Christianity have, at the instigation of the rabbis, become Jews with great blasphemy and outrage to God. Radzivill's commissars in Slutsk demanded an explanation from the local community. This was illegal to convert to Judaism. Which confidently replied, the community replied to the commissars, that the convert's return to Judaism was legal under a 1650 ruling of King Jan Kazimierz that allowed forced converts to return to the religion of their fathers. The commissars, however, were having none of that. They rejected the claim, arguing that the royal order had not been endorsed by the Sejm, and so had no validity on noble estates like those of the Radzivills. The return to Judaism was thus deemed illegal. This provided exactly the pretext necessary, and on June 7th, the Slutsk community was ordered to present to the commissars a register of local Jews. And just 2 days later, an order to expel all the others, the foreign Jews, was issued. And they went. Once again, however, the legislation seems to have been ineffective. Very often in Poland and Lithuania, trying to expel Jews was very ineffective. They seem to go and they come back and they have ways of dealing with the problem. So complaints continue to be made of foreign Jews thronging the town. This suggests that the expellees had soon returned and that the stream of refugees coming to Slutsk had not stopped. None of those Jews could have stayed there or in dozens of similar communities across Poland and Lithuania without the help of the locals, who not only opened their doors to them quite literally, but were prepared to enter into confrontation with non-Jewish society on their behalf. The local community succeeded in organizing itself so it could provide the refugees with housing, ways to make a living, and to the extent possible, protection. All in all then, the ways in which the local communities dealt with the refugee issue on all its different levels can only be described as a remarkable success, giving the refugees both the chance of survival and possibly also the chance to return home. Okay, so that's the second chapter, and move on to the third, facing the refugee experience, social and psychological issues. Those who had lost loved ones or undergone the traumatic experience of fleeing for their lives could not but be marked psychologically. We've already seen Yisrael ben Aharon, the young refugee from Uman, a boy alone on a roof in Lusk, weeping uncontrollably and banging his head on a wall as he begged God to impart some of his divine light. In another case, quite different level, a Jewish refugee from Western Ukraine, I have no more details than that, sadly, called Meir ben Yitzchak, appeared before the rabbi of Pinchuv in Little Poland and made a confession. This is, I quote, his confession. Years ago, he said, I transgressed before the Lord God of hosts in the sin of masturbation through evil thoughts and touching a married woman, though we did not sleep together and I had no intercourse with her. At that time, in Ukraine, I made a full and complete confession before two rabbis who arranged a program of repentance for me, which I fulfilled. However, today, that means nothing to me, for I can see that God is taking out his anger on his people Israel in Ukraine. I say to myself, perhaps it is my sins that have caused all this. So please, he asked the rabbi in Pinchuk, be even more strict with me with further very harsh punishments. Though the lack of detail makes it difficult to tell for sure precisely what was going on, this strange story does emphasize the sorts of psychological damage that could be caused by the kind of traumatic experiences the refugees had to undergo. It's hard for a non-expert to understand the significance of Ben Yitzhak's confession. So I consulted Louis Aron, professor of psychology at NYU. In his reading, Meir ben Yitzchak's insistence on his own personal guilt for the outbreak of the massacres was probably a way for him to overcome his own feelings of impotence in the face of all the violence that was going on. By taking on himself the responsibility for all the horrors, he could see himself not just as helplessly and passively swept up in events, but rather as a key actor in them. That would have made him a figure of importance in the world, not just another miserable refugee. So in the strange and rather twisted fashion, his urgent desire to do further repentance for his sins was probably a way of helping him restore some sense of order and meaning to a life that had been brutally turned inside out. Of course, since each person had a different psychological makeup and experienced different things in the course of his or her flight, it's impossible to generalize. It's impossible to generalize as to the psychological effects of the refugee experience. It's heartening to read, for example, that Yisrael ben Aharon, the boy from Lusk, showed no signs of continuing depression, right, a mark of PTSD, later in life, but rather expressed his happiness at being rabbi of Shklov. Still, whatever psychological effects it may or may not have had, the refugee experience was never something that could just be pushed to one side and forgotten. It was always of huge significance in the lives of those who survived it and had to be dealt with in one way or another. Fortunately for them, the survivors did not have to cope with it alone. Jewish society organized to help them. Crucial in that effort was a special session of the Council of Four Lands, Polish Jewry's lay and rabbinic parliament, which was held in the spring of 1650. Foremost among the issues it dealt with were social questions, questions of identification, particularly of the dead. This was because in order to remarry, Jewish women who had lost their husbands had to prove beyond a doubt that their spouse was in fact dead. If they didn't do that, they couldn't remarry. Jewish law sets a strict evidentiary standard that has to be met. During the uprising, however, with thousands of refugees on the roads, this was extremely difficult to meet. So the council and the rabbis seem to have sat together and drawn up new regulations to ease the problem of identifying the dead so as to allow as many widows as possible to remarry. Another social issue that had to be faced was that of conversion. A great many Jews in Ukraine had either been forced to convert or had chosen to convert out of fear. Now, Jewish law does not recognize conversions, voluntary or forced. So Jewish society felt a pressing need to have the converts return to Judaism. The council seems to have sent a delegation on its own part to the new king, Jan Kazimierz, to request a ruling on the matter. Now, the king's order, which I mentioned above, was remarkably liberal, certainly for the 1650s, allowing all Jews converted to Orthodoxy during the war, whether by force or from fear, to return to Judaism without hindrance. In addition to solving these difficult social problems faced by the refugees, The council meeting also dealt with the religious and cultural aspects of their experience by establishing a day of remembrance for the dead of the uprising. This was a general day of fasting and prayer to be held each year on the Jewish date 20th Sivan, the anniversary of the great massacre at Nemiriv. It was clearly meant to be a day for the living, especially the survivors, to remember the dead. The memory it preserved, however, was of a very particular nature, for it was not tied solely to the event that triggered it. 20th Sivan, though indeed the anniversary of the Nemiriv massacre, was by no means the day on which the killing of the Jews had begun. That had been months earlier. Instead, what recommended this date to the council was that it had already been used as a memorial day by Jews centuries before to commemorate the deaths in a medieval blood libel. The memory that the council created, therefore, was one that connected the events of 1648 with a larger continuum of Jewish suffering. It did not take long for Polish and Lithuanian Jews to begin. No, this form of remembrance sat squarely in the medieval Jewish tradition of memorializing such traumatic events, which tended to portray them typologically as belonging to broad patterns of Jewish experience. For the early modern Jews of Poland and Lithuania, however, this seems no longer to have been enough. They wanted prayers that would also express their own specific experiences and suffering. It did not take long for Polish and Lithuanian Jews to begin composing special prayers to be read on 20th Sivan. Much of this liturgical poetry did not go into great deal about the event, into great detail about the event of 1648, but often included at least some concrete information, the year, the groups involved in the murders, the sites of the major massacres, and the names of the prominent victims. Most prayers, of course, also included a call for divine vengeance on the murderers. In the end, these prayers never fully resolved the tension between the desire to commemorate the sufferings of the day with the traditional requirement to connect contemporary disasters with those of the past. And this probably reflected the feelings of the survivors themselves, who wanted the liturgy to express both their own experiences and to tie them in with the Jewish past. The importance of that lay in the feeling that by integrating the massacres into the long history of Jewish suffering, the survivors could see themselves as participants in the cosmic drama of God's relations with his people Israel. All the terrible events and traumas they had undergone were therefore not a sign that God had abandoned them. Quite the reverse, they were living proof of his ongoing relationship with them. Beyond these theological issues, the fast day and prayers recited on it seem also to have provided the kind of psychological crutch that many of those touched by the traumatic events would have needed in order to move on from their experiences. One of the most important ways of overcoming trauma is to help the survivor integrate horrific memories, the horrific memories of what they've been through, into their own life story. Now, 20th Sivan provided a controlled framework for remembering and talking about the events, and by its very nature, integrated them into the flow of Jewish life by means of its regular place in the calendar. It also did so within the framework of the local community, providing the kind of social safety net that is today widely recognized as crucial in helping overcome refugee and other forms of trauma. Obviously, the leaders who instituted the fast day knew nothing about the treatment of trauma or the positive psychological benefits that their decision would bring to survivors. They were simply following a tried and tested tradition stretching back into Jewish antiquity. Nonetheless, when one looks at the speed with which Polish Lithuanian and particularly Ukrainian Jews managed to resume the threads of their lives after the uprising, the kind of psychological help and support they received can surely not have been a negligible factor. Okay, the final chapter, we're getting towards the end. Strategies of return and reconstruction. Though a significant number of the refugees never made it back to Ukraine, either by force of circumstance or by choice, many more did. Once they'd done so, the returning refugees had, together with those whom they'd left behind, to rebuild their society, sometimes almost from scratch. This involved dealing with a number of social, economic, and religious problems in order to create a solid basis for renewed Jewish life in the places where they'd lived. Finally, steps needed to be taken in the direction of growth. First of all, to recoup all that had been lost during the wars, and then to ensure the community's future development. Mind you, just returning home was not always as easy as it seemed. The sheer size of the disaster that had taken place there gave many pause for thought. As I said, parallels were drawn between the destruction in Ukraine and the destruction of the temple in Jerusalem, the greatest tragedy in Jewish history. People even began to question whether one could or even should return to such a place. Evidence of this feeling can be found in an entry in the community record book of the Chortkiv community. I quote, "As a result of the terrible disasters of 1648 in Ukraine, when the whole region of Podilia was thrown into an uproar, the rabbis of the four lands ruled that no Jew should live here. Such an order forbidding the return to Ukraine seems to echo the traditional view that the rabbinical authorities had forbidden the Jews to resettle in Spain following the 1492 expulsion. However, unlike what happened in Spain, Ukrainian Jews did return home as soon as the fighting had died down. It was not easy for them. They were returning to a land ravaged by war, towns largely destroyed, and Jewish communities sometimes quite literally decimated. What that must have felt like can be seen in a short autobiographical vignette written many years later by Meir Tarnopoler, who remembered vividly what was for him the childhood experience of returning to his hometown of Ternopil. I quote, "In 1648, had the grace of God not moved my father and one or two other community members to move quickly and flee the fighting, we would probably all have died. We were hurried from town to town and from place to place in the heat and the cold. When winter came, we went back to our own town. Our houses had been burned down and our property taken over by strangers, by me, non-Jews. We had many years of sorrow. While our father was alive, he would look after us like a bird watching over its chicks. But after he passed away, our daily lives became unbearable." As well as pointing out the emotional difficulties the refugees suffered in returning to such devastation, this short text also tells of some of the more concrete problems they faced. First and foremost, of course, their economic situation was considerably worse than it had been before the war. Their property, particularly if it was real estate, was likely to have been destroyed or seriously damaged. Other possessions had often been stolen or appropriated in their absence. In such conditions, simply surviving from day to day was a serious challenge. And with life on a knife edge, any other problems, such as the loss of a breadwinner in Tarnopoler's account, must have had the most serious consequences. Once the Jews were back in town, they began to reconstitute Jewish society. In many places, the Jewish communities were up and running very quickly. The next major concern was ensuring the community's economic base. This meant getting back as much as possible of the property that had been abandoned when the Jews fled. In many, if not most cases, buried property was retrieved, and those friends and neighbors to whom the Jews had entrusted their possessions returned them without demur. However, sometimes things had been stolen, and their new owners did not want to give them back. In such cases, the Jews had to go to court for restitution. Israeli historian Moshe Rossman has studied the first 2 years of the Jews' return to the Ukrainian town of Dubno on the basis of the urban records. He notes that of crucial importance was the fact that within weeks of the return of peace, the non-Jewish urban institutions of the town council, and particularly the court, had reconstituted themselves and were dealing with myriad cases of claims and counterclaims of Jews and non-Jews concerning stolen property or damages. Interestingly, though religious and ethnic tensions had played a large part in the violence, the courts seem to have ignored this aspect of events entirely. Whether Jews, Catholics, or Orthodox Christians were involved, the cases were treated purely as civil or criminal matters. Many thousands of such cases were pursued as society, Jewish and non-Jewish, struggled to put its life back together. It is perhaps a sign of Jewish society's confidence in the Commonwealth's legal system that even after the outburst of violence they had suffered at the hands of their non-Jewish neighbors, a great number of returning Jewish refugees appeared before the court to pursue their claims for justice. A different socio-religious issue that called for resolution concerned Jews who had converted to Christianity during the wars, but now wanted to return to Judaism. Not all converts felt that way. Some, perhaps many, preferred to remain as Christians. Those who did want to return found themselves in a complicated situation. Even though Jewish society in the council had made legislation they could return, acceptance into the Jewish world was not always automatic. Jewish law mandates that it's forbidden for Jews to convert, even under duress. They should rather be martyred. So following the strict record, the strict letter of the law, there should have been no converts left to want to return. Anyone in that position had clearly broken the law. Nonetheless, the realities of wartime life meant that there were many converted Jews returning from captivity who now wanted to resume their previous lives. The great legal authority of the previous century, Reb Moshe Isserles of Krakow, cognizant of the conditions in Eastern Europe, had given his own minority ruling that forced converts who wanted to return should be accepted unconditionally. And in the conditions of the 17th century, many of the Eastern European rabbis decided to adopt his approach. The next challenge that faced the returning refugees was to resume their economic life. As the text by Mayor Tarnopoulos suggests, this could be very difficult, at least in the immediate post-war period. The urban markets were in disarray, regional and trans-regional trade was difficult and dangerous, and the high levels of destruction meant that production levels had fallen dramatically. However, as much as this posed a threat to Jewish society, it also presented an opportunity. In the largely agricultural economy of the region, many non-Jewish townspeople abandoned trade or craft in the terrible conditions of wartime and relied instead on subsistence farming in order to survive. Jews who were not allowed to own land were forced to remain in their urban occupations, whatever the conditions. This meant that in order to keep the economy afloat in the difficult times, they had to fill in the gaps left by their non-Jewish neighbors. The upside of this was that once production finally began to rise again and the markets to flourish, the Jews found themselves much more deeply embedded in the urban economy than they had been before the uprising. And this also included, as we saw in Slutsk, having control of more of the town's housing stock. And so they were better able to benefit from the upturn. The Jews therefore seem to have emerged from the catastrophe more quickly and more strongly than their non-Jewish neighbours. The final phenomenon of the immediate post-war years that we will examine here brings us back to the courts. As Jewish life began to resume, there was a wave of prosecutions for murder brought by Jews against those suspecting of killing members of their, i.e. the Jews' families. These were criminal prosecutions. And though they noted that the murders had taken place during the war, they did not view that context as in any way pertinent to the case in hand. Those accused were mostly peasants or townspeople who had taken the law into their own hands and killed Jews during the chaos of the uprising, and so were accused of murder, plain and simple. Bringing murderers of Jews to trial was known in that Jewish culture as taking revenge, and was by no means a new phenomenon in the mid-17th century. Still, an authority of the time, Menachem Mendel Krochmal, explained the purpose of this kind of revenge as follows. If, he wrote, God forbid, we did not take revenge on the murderers, then Jewish blood would be worthless, and people would continue to treat them, i.e. the Jews, in this way. This would endanger every Jew on the road. In this sense, legal revenge was a communal imperative. However, it had implications that went well beyond that. First and foremost, it allowed surviving family members the satisfaction of feeling that at least a certain amount of justice had been done. However, the use of the term revenge for these acts of prosecution is also interesting because it brings them into a kind of dialogue with Jewish liturgy. The memorial prayers of the day almost all included a call for divine revenge on the non-Jewish murderers. Of course, that vengeance would only come at the end of days. So no matter how deeply the Jews believed that it would come, it gave no relief to their immediate feelings of anger and helplessness. Putting the religious passivity of the prayers together with the active prosecution of the murderers under the single rubric of revenge must have allowed contemporary Jews to feel that their legal actions were in some way an expression of God's will. More than that, it surely gave them the sense that God was not simply allowing them to suffer year after year until the arrival of the Messianic Age. Instead, he was encouraging Jews to play an active role in their own fate by taking revenge on their murderers now, just as he himself would do at the Day of Judgment. There must have been a great deal of satisfaction in that. One might even argue that by providing outlets for revenge in both liturgy and litigation, Jewish society allowed the traumatized refugees to sublimate their dark desires for vengeance and channel the harmful emotions in directions more conducive to their mental health. Finally, to conclude, though Ukrainian Jewry suffered a catastrophe of unimaginable proportions during the Khmelnytsky Uprising, which involved a huge loss of life, money and property, as well as a massive displacement of its population, it displayed quite remarkable resilience. The secret of the Jews' success in overcoming the disaster seems to have laid in their ability to adapt to the changing conditions, to be flexible under pressure, right, and their skill in improvising new solutions to a whole range of difficult problems. Jewish society was extremely active in helping returning refugees rebuild their shattered lives, helping not just solve their social, economic, and legal problems, but also providing a measure of relief for at least some of the religious, cultural, and even psychological challenges that they faced. By integrating the returnees back into Jewish life in these ways, it was in fact creating a very solid foundation for first the reconstruction and then the renewed growth of the destroyed Jewish communities. It is particularly noteworthy that while most Jews experienced the traumas of flight as individuals or families, the post-war rebuilding was done to a great extent as communities. It was this communal approach that, as much as anything else, characterized the way in which Polish-Lithuanian Jews dealt with the problems raised by the refugee crisis and helped the survivors and returnees back onto their feet. This was a process not without tensions and difficulties, and it involved much suffering. Still, as the years passed, it led to the Jews being increasingly well-positioned to grasp the opportunities that would come their way as they consolidated their position in the urban economy. So, by the time the magnates began to call on the Jews to return to running their estate economies, the Jews' processes of community rebuilding and socioeconomic reconstruction were far enough advanced that they were able to take up the invitation. Beyond this, the relative weakness of the non-Jewish townspeople, who do not seem to have developed parallel strategies of reconstruction, meant that the previous economic relationship between magnates and Jews not only resumed, but intensified. And since the magnates would become the major political, social, and economic force in Poland and Lithuania for at least the next century, the Jews found themselves in a much more comfortable position, able to leave the traumas of the past behind them and move into the future with a greater degree of confidence. Thank you very much.